From the And the Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands, my name is Mix Master G and welcome to this tutorial. My job is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my job is to educate and teach you about collection conversion and management for DJs so you save yourself more time for the creative part of being a DJ. One of the most common problems about DJs and collections of tracks is that sometimes your record box, Serato, Mixed in Key or whatever software you are using loses its settings for the tracks. Cues are lost, tracks are lost, loops are lost, analyzation data is lost. Some DJ software has more problems within this than others, but all of them to a certain extent have this problem. And this problem revolves about what is known as the file path. A file path is basically the way an OS addresses a certain track on your drive or even on your web server. Just like how an email address addresses the person you want to email to, or how an URL takes you to a certain web page. Now, these file paths can be very intimidating. They can be very scary. They've got all kinds of slashes in them and you know what. So let me take you through the file path first, show you what it looks like so you know what we are dealing with. Then I'm going to use Rekordbox to show you the problem and why it happens. I will explain to you why it happens. And then we come to the most important part of this. Be aware that certain apps, iTunes being one, Mixed in Key being one, but there are more apps like that, change the file path of your tracks without you knowing it. And at that moment, if you don't be aware of that, your cues and loops will be lost in Engine, Prime, Rekordbox, wherever you are. So this is important stuff, folks. You need to wrap your head around this, but I try to make this as easy as possible. As you can see, I got the Candy Shop, which is kind of my default demo track these days, in the demo folder on the desktop. Now, first, let me show you what the file path looks like. And to make that visible, I just use Text Edit, which we all have, and I switch it to a flat text mode. Now, if I drag this in, you all of a sudden see the file path there in front of your eyes. Now, just like with an email address or just like with an URL, if you change one tiny little character, it becomes an entirely different track. Like if you change one tiny character in an email address, it becomes a different addressee. It becomes a different receiver. The same with a file track or with a file path. So if I, for instance, name this the Candy Shop, and we drag it in again, you see that all of a sudden it becomes candyshop.mp3 at the end. Now let's go and show you what happens. I'm going to use Rekordbox as my default demonstration app, but this is not only restricted to Rekordbox. So don't mind that I'm using Rekordbox for the demonstration because it makes it the most visible, but you can expect these kind of troubles with any DJ software, period. And here we are. I make it this a little bit smaller and so that we can reach all the stuff. It's an empty Rekordbox collection, as you can see, which is always the case with my demonstrations. And let's take in the Candy Shop track. Now, in order to link cues, loops, analysis data, etc., Rekordbox uses the file path of a track to identify the track. And you can see that file path here inside the location. And I put it right on front of the screen so you can easily see it. I'm going to give this track a few cues. Let's put a cue there. Let's put a cue there. And let's set a memory loop there. All right, that has been done. I quit Rekordbox. Now let me change one tiny little character on the tracks file, which means we change the file path. By the way, if I change the containing folder to something else, it also changes the file path. If I move the track to a different drive, it also changes the file path. But to keep things very simple, we name the track Candy Shop. We go back to Rekordbox. And remember, we gave this track some loops and cues. Now watch what happens if I load this track up in the deck. All of a sudden, Rekordbox asks me to analyze it because it's a new file path. So Rekordbox doesn't recognized track. It thinks it's a new track. You can see we've got a duplicate there in our collection, and you can see we don't have the cues and loops. Now, if I try to load this track, I will get an error because it cannot be found. Lucky enough, this is easy to restore because I know what I did. I put an E behind the P. So if we take that away and we call it Candy Shep again, and I load it again, everything is there again. However, if you do this with batches of tracks and you don't know which tracks actually change their file path, you can see that this is going to be a tremendous big problem. Another thing, this track won't load anymore because if I load it, it will tell it's not available. So let's remove it from the collection, which I just did. Go back to my track and I'm going to duplicate this one. The duplicate has the word copy behind its name, which means its file path is different from the one we originally used, which means if I load it up, Rekordbox will tell me that it's a new track and treat it as such. It will be analyzed, as you can see. And there it is, without any cues. Now, if you put a test cue there, let's make it a memory cue, because that way we can easily find what is going wrong. Now I've got two tracks, which are virtually the same tracks. We can't tell the difference because we look at the location of the track. But if you strictly look at the title and even the commands or whatever common text you have inside, it is a duplicate. However, this track has the test memory queue, and this track has the memory queues we set previously. Again, the file path dictates if a track is unique to the collection or not, and the file path to the track dictates which kind of cues, loops, or other metadata you set to the track will be used. Keep this in mind. This is where all things go wrong. And again, it's not for Rekordbox only. It's for virtually any DJ software that it works like this. Now, if you got your head around this, if you understand the concept that the file path links to the DJ metadata, and that when you change the file path, the DJ metadata will be lost, we can take it to the next level. Because a lot of artists, like myself, use iTunes to, well, maintain their collection, to make the playlist, to make the folders, to set the common text correct, so titles and artists are correct, etc. And then go to their DJ software of choice. In our demo case, it will be Rekordbox. Let me show you what can go wrong with iTunes and why I'm always so persistent about using specific settings. Let me double check the settings for this iTunes, because this is my empty default collection. And usually your iTunes settings will be like this if you start it up. These are the default Mac Mojave iTunes settings, which means you don't have an XML, which means Rekordbox doesn't know about the existing of iTunes tracks. So you have to turn that off. And these two, the top two, are on. And those two are the culprit of every problem with Rekordbox. Because let me show you what is going to happen. And we give this track a green ball, so we can easily identify it. And I load it in iTunes. iTunes have loaded the track. Now, let me show you what has happened without you knowing it. In the back, iTunes has moved the track. It has moved the track inside the music folder, iTunes folder, media folder, in a very proprietary iTunes storage structure. Let me first take the file path of this track and put it right there, so you can see where it's headed and you can read where it's located. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to change the title of the track. Let's change it from Candy Shop 1A to just plain Candy Shop. There we are. Change the track. Now let me show you what has happened. Because if I show it in the Finder again, there it is. And we put it underneath the previous one, you see the file path has changed. Ergo, if I change the name of the track, iTunes will rename the track and will change the file path. The very same thing happens if I change an artist. For instance, we have 50 Cent and Olivia. We changed it, as you can see. And let me find the track again, show in Finder. Let me give some room. Remember, we are still talking about the same track and all of a sudden iTunes moved it. This movement will cause loss of cues and loops in Rekordbox. And for those who don't believe me, I'm going to show you again. So let's take it from the top. We've got The Candy Shop by 50 Cent and Olivia right there. And we want to put that in Rekordbox. Now let's open the iTunes tab and show you all the tracks, which is just one right here, and load it inside the deck. Notice that Rekordbox does not know about this track. We have worked so much in iTunes on the file path that this will be again a completely new track, which indeed will get an analyzation. Now if I look at the collection, you see three versions of the same track. I've got a triple duplicate here. And if I load this one up, I can load it just fine. Give it a couple of cues. Load the other one up just for good measures. Now I go back to iTunes. I renamed it Andy Shop, as you can see. And let's double check that indeed it did what it's supposed to do. Reload the track again. And it cannot be found. Now, iTunes does something tricky in the back without you knowing it, because iTunes doesn't use the file path. iTunes uses a very proprietary Apple way to identify tracks on your hard drive. Only if that track is formatted HFS or APFS, which are the proprietary Apple ways of formatting a drive, this works. But if I look inside my iTunes collection, and I have to refresh it for good measures, you could already see the exclamation mark disappearing. It will load again. And again, it's a new track. And again, I lost my cues and loops. So this is what goes wrong if you keep those settings in iTunes the way I left them. Now let me show you what happens if you use the settings as I always advocate. Go back to iTunes. Go back to the preferences. And we disable these two settings. Switch them off. That means you are manually in charge of where you put your tracks. But that's a good thing, because that makes you knowing where they are. And that makes you sure that nothing will rename the tracks, hence changing the file path, hence losing cues and loops. So that's why those two are off. Now let me show you again what happens. Let me restore. You know what? You move that one to the trash. Let's take the original green dotted one. There it is. Now if I look where it's located, you'll see indeed it is in the demo folder exactly as I want it to be. Quit iTunes. You always have to quit iTunes to update the XML. That's a thing some people forget. If you forget it, all the latest changes are not written to the XML, so Rekordbox cannot use them. Quit iTunes. Refresh the iTunes part, and now we can load it up, and you can already see the cues are there because it was already part of the collection. And to make that even easier, you can see we've got all those previous duplicates. Let me remove them. Indeed, it's the Candy Shop one that is loaded, so let's remove these ones because we don't want duplicates in our collection. And now it doesn't matter, we can load it from here or we can load it from the Rekordbox collection. And everything remains the same. Now I create a playlist in iTunes. Let's name it Test. And I put the Candy Shop inside there. And I edit its tags like this. So it's named Testing now. And as you can see, nothing changed to my file path. It's still exactly where we all expect it to be with the green dot. I quit iTunes, I go back to Rekordbox, I refresh the iTunes XML, which is a necessity, and then I say Sync Manager, Sync All Playlists, which is what we did right now. And then you can see it automatically takes this with us. It takes the track name with it. So I changed the track name. It makes it over to my collection. The same if I give it stars in iTunes. If the track is in a playlist, then everything will be. Let's switch to the song view, because I really hate this view, Apple. Why did you make this? View as songs. There we are. And take a rating with it. Give it 4 stars. Quit it again. Refresh everything. Go to the sync manager. There we are. And if we go to the ratings, you can see it has 4 stars. So this is the proper way to use iTunes with Rekordbox or with Traktor or with Serato or with whatever. Make sure you manage the storage of your tracks manually. And because you use playlists and folders, it really doesn't matter what folder they are in. Just dump them in one big folder with the year you bought them, and that would be fine. Only important thing is know where they are and make sure that you backup that folder, of course, which speaks for itself. Another thing, talking about file paths and changing file paths. Mixed in Key has an option to rename your track in the preferences, to rename a track so it reflects the key and the energy level and the BPM or whatever you want in the track's file name. Again, this is killing DJ metadata for existing tracks. If you do this first before you introduce a track to the collection, it's fine with me. But if you do it after a track is already in Rekordbox, you will lose all your analysis data. You will lose your cues and loops in Engine Prime. You will lose the analysis data in Traktor, in Serato, in whatever. So do not rename files by Mixed in Key unless you do it prior to introducing them to your DJ software, period. Then another word about names for tracks. I collected a couple of test tracks right here, and as you can see, they've got the most peculiar names. They've got Chinese characters, they've got accented characters, they've got, I think it are Greek characters, I'm not sure, sorry folks. I just copy and pasted them, so I really don't know what they are. These characters can create a problem in your DJ software, because those file paths can be encoded, can be recognized in different ways. And to make sure that you don't have any conflict there, it's best to clear your tracks of those characters. And I created an app for that, and that app comes free with any app I sell, because this is so important. This is at the heart of collection management. Having a properly named track, I just gave it away. The app in question is called the Track Rename Tool, and if you drag just a folder containing tracks over it, it will give you a warning because it will change the file paths. So only do this if tracks have already been introduced to your collection, which is what I want. And you can see that happening in real time. All of a sudden, everything has changed, and the only thing in those file names now are common ASCII characters, which will always work everywhere. So that's why this is important, and that's why you have to do this before you introduce tracks to your collection. I hope I made a little bit of sense about the mysterious file paths, why they are important, and why they need to be static, why you don't need to change your file path ever once a track is inside your DJ software collection. If you got questions, leave them in the remarks. If you like the videos I make, give them a thumbs up. Mixmaster G signing off.